I want to thank you for coming and just kind of get into your background story real quick.
Yeah, I mean, we don't even know exactly when we did meet, but we certainly have been friends ever since. And what was intriguing to me about Ben is that he was open to whatever was going to help his patients. That was paramount. That was the first thing. And regardless of what had to be done to get that patient there, as long as it was science-based and it made good physiological sense, he was very open to it. So back in the 80s, the MDs and the DCs, we weren't really super tight. And so it was really an anomaly, and it was a really positive one. So it was something that we just kind of organically built upon. There was no stress, no extra effort put in. It was just kind of one of those natural things where, you know, all of a sudden I have this tremendous asset in this man that knows so much more than I do in a different genre, though about the same topic. And it was an amazing kind of collaboration. Mm-hmm. Whenever we got together, I learned something new. I've had 30 years of learning based on just on this friendship with Ben.
Well, from my perspective as an orthopedic surgeon, my training was to identify what the structural problem was that the patient had that I could take to the operating room and correct. We were trained to correct anatomy. And it was clear to me that that wasn't the whole solution, because I would do a surgery and some patients did well and some patients didn't do as well. So there had to be a component of function involved. And that for me, originally, my training evolved, was physical therapy rehabilitation. But then I started thinking about, what are the things that could have prevented the injury? And so we wouldn't have had the structural problem, and that became an issue of function. And that was around the time that I ran into Tim, and he was a guy that didn't talk like the other chiropractors spoke. I could actually understand him. If we didn't understand, there was enough mutual respect from the get-go that we could talk to each other and figure out what we were using different words, but a lot of times saying the same thing. So if we're thinking the same way, coming from it at two different angles, then obviously we can work together to help our mutual patients. And that's when we started having a lot of mutual patients, because we realized that neither one of us had all the pieces to the puzzle, but together we had a lot more pieces and a lot more puzzles got put together. The first time I was involved in a collaborative effort with people, medical professionals that were not only MDs, was working with Tim and covering, I don't even remember if it was a surf contest or a volleyball contest, and Tim had the foresight to start putting together multidisciplinary groups. So it was physicians and physical therapists and chiropractors and osteopaths and body workers, people that did yoga, anybody that could help his athletes. And so I showed up at the beach, and being a kid from the Bronx, didn't have a lot of beach time in my past, and all of a sudden here are all these medical professionals. And the team that Tim put together just played off of each other. So there were no egos involved. It was, if you had something to offer, you said it. Nobody had turf, and the only turf was that which the athlete that we were dealing with owned. And so we were coming onto their turf trying to figure out what could we do to benefit them. So, I mean, that just opened my eyes to what it could be. And to be honest, Tim was the first healthcare professional that I ever worked with who did that. And so I didn't even know the terms that I needed to put on what I was looking at and thinking about function, but that's what it was. So I was looking at anatomy, physiology, and Tim is looking more at biomechanics and kinematics and things like that. So it's where is the failure? So for me, it basically got reverse engineered. You know, here's the injury. How do I avoid the injury? What could have caused it? But this guy made me think. And he made me not think more than I wanted to, but think more than perhaps I was trained to.
I kind of just echo what Ben's sentiments are. Even though I'm a sports chiropractor, in school we learn structure, where it's all about the spine and the nervous system, which is all good and well, and there's a great place for that, but it's very limiting if you think that that is the source of all disease. I mean, how did the spine get out of alignment? It's the same reason for how an ankle blew out or a shoulder blew out. There were some, it was placed in an environment that over time set it up for injury. So that's why when I treat a low back, the low back's the last place I look. Though I respect it, I honor it, and I examine it, it's not how I treat it. I treat the person, I treat the imbalances, and the further away I can get from the spine and make that correction, I think the healthier it is for that patient, because it allows them to also get involved in their own treatment. So their feedback is so important, and just as important as a good history, which is also a paramount in what Ben and I agree upon. The answer's in the patient, usually not in us, and it's up to us to ask those questions that bring out those answers that allow us to look at their function, because we both believe that life is movement and movement is life, and without movement, things go the opposite direction that we want them to go. So we really have come to a point where we don't really look at structure as much as we look at movement and what creates the irritation in that structure because of an abnormal or poor quality of movement.
We all understand we sit too much,
yeah.
Right? So then what are you guys seeing clinically for people who sit too much and how that's impacting the body?
We're a product of what we do all day long. But what you do and the choices you make outside of those time periods, the rest of the day for those 20 plus hours, are what you become. And so what we've learned is that we sit about 9.3 hours a day on average in the United States. We sit so much and it's caused so many problems that now physicians can rate your mortality based upon how long you sit. They can also predict the type of diseases that you'll have chronically as you get older based upon how long you sit. So that's really been a big effort of mine as of late in the last few years, is to really get people to, hey, if they really want to change their health, do a couple things. One, stop sitting so much and get a stand-up desk. And two, work on your posture, because it seems to affect the health and well-being of every cell and every system of your body. So two very seemingly simple things that can actually have a tremendous impact on one's health. So when I treat someone's back, it's not just about that treatment. It's really, if I'm gonna have a long-term effect, which is my ultimate goal with that patient, my ultimate goal is to not see that patient. And to do that, I have to prescribe to them different choices that they can make during their day that are gonna change the very reason for them coming to my office. So that's kind of it in a general sense with low back stuff. The ones that get injured the most are the ones that play to train and don't train to play. When we reach a certain age in our lives, that sitting and all that schooling's taken effect, our bodies change and they shorten up and they adapt to, again, what you're doing the most. When you're not playing the most all day long and you're sitting the most all day long or not moving, your body adapts to that. And then you want to go out and go from 0 to 60 and go get in a pickup game. Pick a body part. It's going to be injured over time. And this isn't stuff I learned in school. It's really stuff that I've experienced as a practicing sports chiropractor.
The major problem we have is the way God designed us. He put our eyes in front of our head instead of on the side or in the back. So our tendency is to look at everything at the horizon level. So we tend to lean forward to do that. The fact that we're now sitting at a computer, we lean forward to watch television, our head and neck go forward, and then we are hunched forward. And so some of the things that Tim was talking about as far as postural things, it really starts from down in the feet. There's what we call a kinetic chain, so that each part of the body interacts with another part. So when I talk to my throwers and I say, when you go to throw a ball, what muscle do you think fires first? And the answer is, if you're a right-handed thrower, it's the muscles in your left calf, because there's a ground reaction force that has to be produced so that you push against the ground so that you can come back to start bringing your arm back. Well, that force gets transmitted through the body. So eventually in the throw, 50% of the energy that's derived for the throw comes from the legs and the trunk. And that then gets funneled through the shoulder, and then your hand and your arm basically put the velocity on the ball, the extra velocity, and place it. The bottom line is, we tend to have our shoulders pitched forward and rotated in like that. But the cue that I give patients as far as positioning their shoulder blades is just elevate your chest. So if you think about, if you're sitting at your desk and you're slumped over, what I give my patients as a cue is I have them put a post-it in the corner of their monitor that it can be very personal, just something to remind them to sit up. It could be their wife's name or anything. And so every time they look into the lower right-hand corner, they go from their usual bad posture of mousing to it's just a sternal lift. And the cue there is, don't let your chest face your keyboard, make your chest face your monitor. So you come up this way, and now all of a sudden, because of the shape of the thorax of your chest wall, your shoulder blades have to come back and down, and now you're in an optimal position. Your shoulder can't function properly if your shoulder blades are forward and rotated in. And so what I do with my patients who aren't buying this is say, well, I want you to just raise your arm and get it up as far as you can in the position you're in. And they usually get up to about here. Okay, now bring it down and raise your chest, and now bring your arm up. And now all of a sudden there's bony clearance for the soft tissues and you can get it in position. So the cue for them is raise your chest. And so during my exam in the office, I make corrective maneuvers to change their symptoms, and as soon as I do that, they're hooked. Now they know they can make themselves better just by working on that, and hopefully, even if there is a structural breakdown, avoid surgery, because you can make the structural abnormality less significant, less clinically significant, less symptomatic, and they may be able to do just fine with it. I have a number of athletes that I'm currently taking care of that are at the Olympic level, that have competed at the Olympics and likely will compete this year, that have structural abnormalities that they've been told need surgery. And by working on a functional approach, a lot of which was taught to me by Tim, they're doing fine. And they have been able to compete, they will be able to compete, and they'll do that without scars. So if I can get somebody better without making an incision, that's great. There's enough surgery to do without doing it on people that don't need it. I think the biggest thing that I do for my patients is I listen to them and I talk to them. And my job, and Tim does the same, you educate the patient so that the next time they come back, you're their coach. I become their orthopedic coach so that they can avoid having problems down the line. If I were to have to come up with an area that needs the most work in the most patients that I see, it's their core and their lumbopelvic area, which is the area from the lumbar low spine to the hips. It's basically the middle of the body, because everything that you do below that and everything that you do above that starts from there. So if you have weakness there, you can't function well. Something's got to break down. But the functional test that I use the most is I have them stand on one leg and I watch to see what do they have to do to maintain their balance. So by doing that, I'm looking at their core stability. There's a difference between core stability and core strength. Core strength, I can do 1,000 sit-ups, I got great abs, I'm strong. Core stability is your ability to stabilize your spinal column against gravity with perturbations. So if somebody tries to push you, can you stabilize? And that's a different kind of strength, and it becomes almost sport specific or function specific. So I have the patient stand on one leg and I'm looking at, are they compensating with their foot? Are they compensating with their knee? Are they compensating with their hips? And where is their pelvis moving in three dimensions? I then have them do a very slow half squat, and that's to determine, are they controlling the muscles around their hip? And there are various cheats that they can do. They can either pitch forward, they can lean to the side, the femur can rotate in. So there are a lot of different ways that they can compensate, but I just have to know what are those compensations and what does that mean to me as far as what their rehab program has to be.
Traditional training that I certainly grew up with playing football in college is way different than what we recommend now. What we recommend now is that you have to have mobility, stability, and strength in your program. You need to attain those in that order. Those that go for strength first are predictably going to be injured. Those that go for stability first, same idea. If you can combine them all into one exercise program, that's great, and there are very few that do that. Also, we tend to overtrain, as Ben mentioned, the front of our body because we use it all day long. We're also right-handed or left-handed, and that needs to be taken into consideration too, because my right side is completely different than my left side. And so balance is the goal, but it's not as easy as 1, 2, 3. And therefore each athlete, patient, needs to be looked at as an individual based upon height, weight, genetics, but also more importantly how they move through life, what their postures are. Those are great identifiers for where an athlete is relative to their fitness. And I've had the honor to work on the world's best athletes in many sports, and they all suffer from these imbalances. They're not alone. But what they do have in common, the best of the best, is the ability to be soft. And by that I mean when I palpate them, They're not, though they look buff, they're not rigid to the touch. They have a certain softness to them. And I think that's what allows their imbalances to still allow them to supersede others in competition. If my athlete can move like a four-year-old, because four-year-olds haven't been inhibited by years of sitting and being right-handed or left-handed, if my athlete can move like a four-year-old, hinge perfectly from the hips as opposed to bending from the waist, then I know my athlete's got a great foundation and that athlete's going to be able to progress probably throughout their career a lot more than most athletes that go into their sport, work on sport-specific training, and become more and more out of balance as their career goes on. And they'd never blame it on their training because, heck, they're training for football or for basketball or for volleyball. But it's my objective to make them train for life first. That's one thing every athlete shares, is that the importance of posture and balance and core strength. And one thing I'd like to point out is that the core isn't in the middle, though this is the most important part of our core. The core extends all the way down to the knees, and it starts just at the diaphragm. And it's not just the front, it's our backs as well. So the core, again, alluding to Ben's conversation, is very 3D oriented. And so as an athlete, if you want to be a great athlete, if you want to progress through your career, if you want to prevent injuries and recover the fastest, these are the most important things for them to have first and foremost within their foundation as an athlete. So you can take an athlete that maybe on the street doesn't look like he's the biggest or the bulkiest, but I'll tell you what, if I had to choose between two athletes, a big bulky guy and a lean, svelte looking athlete, I'd go for that lean athlete every time, because I know it's such an obligation when you have a body that's bigger and stronger. It takes much more maintenance to keep that on point and in balance than it does for someone who trains in 3D and who trains for life and who trains for movement as opposed to training for a sport.
So some of the stuff I'm known for what I lecture on, a lot of the basis came from just sitting and talking to this guy at the beach, you know, and I'm calling it work. It wasn't a bad gig. It still isn't.